Hey everybody, I'm Random Bystander here, and boy do I have something good here today. I cannot wait to see what's inside. Oh my god. It's $10 worth of eShop points!
Has this ever happened to you? It's some sort of special gift-giving event. Your birthday, Christmas, Hanukkah, Valentine's Day, Arbor Day, I don't care, you're getting a gift. Someone is feeling generous, and all they know about you is that you have a Nintendo Switch. You get a gift from that amazing special friend, and in that present is a box, and in that box is another box, and in that box is an envelope, and then that envelope is the holy goodness of Nintendo currency. A Nintendo Switch eShop gift card. But for only $10. Nintendo Switch games cost a lot of money. The average first-party Switch title costs $40 to $60 for both physical and digital copies. Sales will happen occasionally, but even then these games break the bank, and that $10 gift card can only put a small dent into that high price point. Why are Switch games so expensive? But are they, though? As it turns out, there are so many Switch games that are not only under $10, but some that are ridiculously cheap. The Great Deals section is a wide variety of games that are affordable on the Switch. It's just that there's one slight problem. No one knows anything about them. These low-budget games are flooding the eShop, yet not many people want to buy them, as these games don't get as much attention as their more well-known AAA and indie competition. No one, especially those with only $10 worth of eShop points, wants to waste their money on a potentially terrible game. And because of that, not a lot of people really talk about these games, making people want to buy them even less. I'm going to change that.
With this $10 eShop gift card, I was able to buy 10 eShop games. Yes! 10 eShop games, all of them for under $5. Heck, some of them for even under a dollar. And we're gonna be taking a look at them all today.
Estiman, 19 cents. We're starting with the cream of the crop in savings, ladies and gentlemen. A game that is not only trippy, but requires mental math.
Not math. Anything but math.
Estiman is a game where you have to take objects, whether they be shapes, stones, or even numbers, and reduce the amount of objects by clicking on them. But in order for you to succeed, you have to click these objects from largest amount of objects to smallest amount. For example, if your screen is filled with 4 circles, 3 triangles, and 2 squares, you have to hit a circle first, then triangle, then square, right in that order, to move on to the next level. You do get a second chance if you mess up if you score a certain amount of points, but after that, game over, try again. The atmosphere of this game is very psychedelic with its music, background visuals, and brightly lit patterns you click on. I feel like I'm watching a laser tag light show. The gameplay is addicting as well, as you always feel like you want to go one more round in order to play. You also get in-game currency from playing the game, which you can use to get more backgrounds and game modes, and the best part, there are no microtransactions. None!
I mean, sure, people may not want to buy microtransactions for a game that's under 20 cents, but hey, give credit where credit is due.
I will say the gameplay does get super fast, and it is so easy to hit the wrong button. But I think that's the nature of the gameplay more than anything. Unfortunately, this is all there is to the game, just clicking the shapes until you lose. A simple game that if you want a nice puzzle challenge, it's not a bad investment of a fifth of a dollar. Pirates, all aboard. 49 cents. If you're looking for a substitute to Sea of Thieves on the Switch, this isn't the game for you. Pirates All Aboard is a multiplayer-focused game where you battle each other's ships in order to sink each other. Last ship standing wins. This one kind of bored me, but that's mostly because the main focus is local multiplayer, and I have no one to play this stuff with. There is a single-player mode and practice mode, but it's really dull. The graphics aren't that impressive, the music is great but gets old very quickly, and look at that, I can run into rocks just fine. My ship is invincible! Never mind. There is a small single-player mode where you have to dodge as many rocks as possible, along with other indescribable things that can kill me. What even is that? It's very repetitive, and I got tired of it.
Out of all the 10 games I bought, I thought this one was the most boring. If you're looking for something piratey and multiplayer and something cheaper, sure, this could be good, but I don't really recommend it that much. You know what? I'm gonna pull a Sakurai. Play Sea of Thieves on Xbox.
My Brother Rabbit, $1.49. If your brother is that rabbit on the cover, your brother looks absolutely terrifying. But on a more serious note, I really recommend this game, especially if you're into point-and-click puzzle games. The visuals are absolutely surreal, yet gorgeous, and give off a sort of Alice in Wonderland type of vibe, with all the weird creatures and out-of-the-box-looking environments. Accompanied with the beautiful music as well creates a unique gaming atmosphere that I haven't seen in a long time. Not to mention, the drawn cutscenes are amazing to watch, and visually help with telling the story. The puzzles consist of finding a group of objects interwoven in the background, and then using those said objects to create a puzzle. Rinse and repeat. If you want a game that challenges you, this game is the one to do it. It is not easy. Not only do items blend in devilishly with the background, how the heck was I supposed to see that? But some of these puzzles were not only creative, but difficult. I had to use a guide halfway through my playthrough with this. It's extremely challenging otherwise. Still, I think this game is absolutely worth the money. The charm of the visuals and the challenge of the puzzles are a nice blend, and this is one of the few games I actually finished. If you like puzzles and point and click, it is more than worth it.
Well, that game took a lot of time. 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 Clock. Clock Simulator!
Clock Simulator, 39 cents. Yep, this game exists, and the title does not lie. All you do in the game is simulate being a clock. Literally press the A button in the time that the clock ticks. This is it. This is Clock Simulator. It's Clock Simulator. It's Clock Simulator! I'm so perplexed! Why does this game exist? And at the same time, why is it more interesting than Pirates All Aboard? I guess even though it is repetitively pressing the A button, you have to do it in a rhythmic motion, so it provides more of a challenge? Some modes require you to follow the rhythm of the clock in order to succeed. Otherwise, game over. I swear, I'm doing it in rhythm as humanly possible, but it still knocks off some points. Why is Clock Simulator so hard? You also get some bonus mini-games, including a pig going through gears that require you to hit the right buttons, multiplayer co-op and versus, yes, multiplayer in Clock Simulator, it's possible, and a mode where you can summon creepy switches with the power of time. I don't like the looks of those guys. Oh, and you can go digital. Yay! The gameplay is simple. Literally all you do is just press A, nothing more. But all the visuals and different modes add variety, and it makes it interesting to play. If you have some extra pocket change, pick it up, even if it is just for the memes.
Nothing can top Clock Simulator. No thing.
No thing. 19 cents. The fact that this is cheaper than Clock Simulator worries me. Developed by Forever Entertainment and Indie Games. This is definitely the most avant-garde of games on the list. Yes, we're busting out the dictionary to describe this one. The goal of the game is to move left and right, while making sure to always stay on the path. All the while, this robotic voice is shouting incoherent and encrypted messages to you.
Your shoes are shining. I am now on your side. I am you and you now. Yeah, we're in bed.
That, along with the digitized and abstract gaming visuals, is both unsettling and intriguing. No Thing screams art game to me, a game that is made to symbolize something, to have deeper meaning. It's entertaining enough, but it seems the goal is not to be entertaining, just to be artsy and show a message of some sort. What is this message?
I don't know, I'm just playing video games.
Who knows? All I do know is that this game is one heck of a trip. Also, the game over screen is one of the loudest and most terrifying I've ever witnessed.
Oh, dear God. Dear God.
Dear God, $1.59. This game, you play as a hunter who gets murdered by a wolf in the woods. The spirit of the hunter approaches a deer spirit, who punishes him to be reincarnated as a deer. I'll just say it, the pixel art looks really good.
Oh, I'm a baby deer.
It is both simple with its sprite models, the deer you play as and other enemies, yet gorgeous with its background images, and I love how it just effortlessly transitions from night to day. The game honestly gives me a lot of Minecraft vibes, especially with its background and music. The gameplay is cool too. You not only have to worry about your health, but also have some survival elements as your deer gets hungry, and you have to eat berries and plants in order to survive. But you aren't completely defenseless, as you can attack other predators and humans. Also, I like the gameplay element that when you die as a deer, you are reborn as another deer, and your save points are, well, spots where you where you got
busy!
I didn't make it too far with this game, but if you want a game where you play as a Bambi god, or try a cool pixelated platformer that you never heard of, Dear God is worth it. I honestly might do a review of this game in full one day, or play it on my Twitch channel,
which you can follow in the description below.
One Strike, 49 cents. This game is a pixelated fighting game that is really addicting. The only catch is there is no life bar. You strike your opponent, and then BAM, they're dead. You do this with all of the fighters until your character finally conquers Japan, along with attacking you can defend as well, as you yourself can die in one hit. It's an intense game, the sprite work is pretty cool, it's local multiplayer so you can play with friends, and best of all, you can play as Satan! Look at how he just murders people. Good job, Satan, look at all that pixelated blood. Akane. $2.99.
I wonder if there's any 16-bit blood splattered in this game. Yay, violence!
The most expensive game on this list, Akane, is rated M for a reason, as there is a lot of death. Not much is explained in the game story-wise, it just looks like you are in a fighting arena and you have to kill as many people possible. You use your sword to just swat people like bleeding flies, and then use your gun to shoot people at a distance. You can't just shoot and swing randomly though, as you have a stamina bar, and if that depletes to zero, you get tired, leaving you vulnerable to attacks. You can get other weapons by completing certain challenges, but I'm not good at this game. It's good, mindless, violent fun, and if you want a good time waster, and want a good hack and slash, I'd say give it a try. Unless you're under 18, then wait a few years first. Robonauts, 39 cents. It starts out with a deleted scene from WALL-E, starring our main character. What is his name? What is this ship? Why does he exist? None of this matters as he gets transported out of his ship into an unknown planet. You get a robotic mech suit, and you have to shoot and kill all the enemies on the planet in order to move on to the next area. You can also hop from planet to planet by pressing the X button, which allows for creative level design. That is, if the gameplay wasn't kind of boring. It's just shooting aliens and killing everything. They add some weapon variety, but the game is just dull. All I'm doing is pressing A, almost as much as I did with Clock Simulator. Don't think I forgot about that game. Why does it exist? That being said, the game has some positives. Graphics do look good, our protagonist looks adorable, and the music is rocking. My favorite thing about the game by far. Also, there's this weird corporation tin can who reminds me of the movie Robots.
Give me those eyes, big eyes, big eyes. Give me big anime eyes.
Overall, not my favorite game, but if you have pocket eShop change, there are worse things you can get. And our last game, Storm Boy, the game, $1.19. Apparently, this is based on a short story by Colin Veal, and by based on, I mean it's literally telling you the story word for word with the visual gameplay. That's basically what the game is, a visual storybook. It's about a boy named Storm Boy, who lives alone in an island with his father, and he rescues and befriends a pelican named Mr. Perceival. I won't spoil anything, but the story itself is pretty good, has its bright moments, dark moments, and even its beautiful moments. There are also some mini-games that are thrown in, such as feeding the pelicans fish, collecting seashells, and drawing things in the sand. Now, what should I draw? Perfect! Oh look, he even shows up on the beach. That's pretty cool. The mini-games, however, are not the best, and definitely not too entertaining if you are over a certain age. Heck, some of the games didn't even work for me. No matter how much I aimed, only the left pelican got food. I guess that's why the other two pelicans never came back. Also, there's this one level where the pelican has to fly, but the wind pulls you off-screen, and you die. Whenever I tried to bring up the controls to figure them out, I wouldn't be too long before I died, as the controls of the game show up on-screen while you are playing the game. It's not a huge problem, and you can honestly skip the section entirely if you feel like it, but it gave me a bit of trouble. But the mini-games are just side games. The meat and potatoes is the visual storytelling and story. And it's fine. I thought I went on a bit too long personally, but I'm not the intended audience for this. Seeing video games used to retell children's literature is really cool. I legit might show them to my nephews when they are old enough. If you're a fan of Colin Veal's work, or you want to get your kids into gaming, I'd say this game is harmless enough.
And that's all the eShop games today. You know, I originally had low expectations for doing something like this, but each game had something unique to offer.
It's a shame a lot of these games don't get the publicity they should, as each of them have something special to bring to the table. Yes, a lot of them are one-and-done experiences, some don't offer a lot of replay value, but especially for the prices each game had, these games were simple, intriguing, and a nice change of pace after so many AAA games on the Switch. Even for games in this list I didn't like, I could tell people worked really hard to create these games. There's passion behind them, and they deserve some love too. My expectations for these games were seriously low, but I found something I enjoyed in nearly all of them. And I was so happy I was able to give these games a try, and give them their chance in the spotlight. If you have some extra cash and are interested in any one of the games mentioned, treat yourself, and try something completely different. This experience was personally a lot of fun for me, and I enjoyed playing games I would usually never try otherwise. Would you want to see me review more cheap Switch games? Please let me know in the comments below.
Well, it looks like I have a bit more money left on my eShop gift card. I wonder what I could spend it on.
What more? Please God, let me honk with my friends. You silly goose, you. Untitled Goose Game. Let's make a game about this adorable menace to society.
It's time to play as a goose.